I'm Sofie Pelsmakers, Professor of Sustainable Housing Design at the Faculty of the Built Environment and Tampere University School of Architecture. I lead the Assotud Sustainable Housing Design Research Group, and together with them, I research the everyday architecture of the living environment and the home within it. So what do I mean by home and living environment? Well, a home is not just the four walls of an apartment or house, but also the housing block with shared spaces and connections from the home to the surrounding neighborhood. This distinction between different scales of the home is important. And I also use the word home as distinct from house or housing. After all, a home is not just a sum of physical attributes, but it also signifies emotional, cultural, and social qualities. It also links to an individual's personal feeling of belonging. A home is a place of refuge, where we can retreat, but also be together with others. A home is about the ability to control, personalize, and adapt our space so that we can be ourselves and thrive. When we think of home instead of housing, the importance of the interconnections with the surrounding living environment becomes clear. The living environment supports the pragmatic but also social functions of the home. It's where we can meet others, where it can provide us with visual and physical connections to urban nature, and where sustainable modes of mobility connect us and support physical activity. The living environment impacts how we live, how our needs and expectations are met, and how healthy and sustainable our lifestyles are or can be. The changing needs of individuals and society affect the physical, spatial, environmental but also social design of the home and the surrounding living environment. And in turn, those conditions affect people and society positively or negatively. And that is why the work we do in investigating housing design and living environments is so important. The needs, expectations, and the very meaning of the home are changing in response to social and environmental changes and challenges, such as climate change and pandemics, but also loneliness, health and well-being, and demographic changes like immigration and an aging population. So what do these challenges mean for housing design? How do experiences, interactions, needs and expectations transform over time? How can we design living environments to better enhance physical and mental well-being? Often such societal challenges are seen as problems to solve, but I also see them as opportunities to challenge a current status quo. An opportunity to reimagine and transform living environments that are truly sustainable and inclusive for all. I'm also interested in how the needs and expectations of a diversity of people are met, how people are affected by their home and living environment, and how it enables or disables a sustainable and healthy lifestyle and the impacts on the wider environment, for example, related to energy use and carbon emissions. And of course, as an architect, I'm also interested in what all of this means for the spatial, social, and environmental design of the home and the living environment. And while people are affected by their living environment, I also try to understand how people can affect and adapt their environment to meet their own everyday needs. Current housing design and development has been a barrier to achieving good living environment quality. We found that people often live in housing that limits their ability to adapt spaces to meet their needs. This negatively affects their well-being. Yet, good housing design quality and associated well-being benefits are a right for everyone, irrespective of income and where they come from, or whether people are young, old, able-bodied, or not. So inclusive and equitable infrastructures are at the heart of sustainable living environments. We also found that this supports individuals and community resilience in the event of adversity, such as, for example, the pandemic. Unfortunately, housing is primarily seen as a financial investment, and as a result, the focus has been on housing as an efficient machine for living in. Yes, a house is a place to eat, sleep, wash, but as I just mentioned before, Housing needs to do more than providing pragmatic necessities. Housing needs to enable each individual to create a home and allow them to thrive. This brings us to the need for versatility, diversity, and adaptability of housing to support the creation of a home. As a society, we're becoming more diverse. We live longer and our lives are less predictable, creating diverse needs and expectations that should also be reflected in our housing design. Yet our research has shown that housing has become less diverse and less versatile. Recently, Finnish housing production has led to ever smaller one-room microunits. These micro-sizes prohibit a meaningful social life taking place at home. Combined with their deep plan, they create dark, unadaptable, tunnel-like spaces with no real furnishability options. They exist just to sleep, eat, wash, alone. Our research, and that of others, has found that one size does not fit all. Yet the drive deficiency has led to universal designs, ignoring users' different preferences and needs for a variety of plan layouts. We also found that in many cases, small units could be adapted and combined together to form larger units in the future. But in reality, this was not considered on the drawing board. The real risk is, of course, that these housing blocks will face premature obsolescence and may be demolished if they cannot adapt to meet changing needs. And this then has resource and climate change implications. We also found that not just adaptable housing, but also green and social infrastructures are key to how the built environment can support resilient, sustainable, and healthy living. I already touched on the need for adaptability, which is crucial for meeting one's own needs in daily life. But it also refers to multifunctionality and multi-usability. For example, a shared space can be used as a space to work from home, as well as a social space for residents to meet after working hours. This reduces the need for resources by avoiding the duplication of spaces and is part of tackling the climate crisis. We also need to adapt our homes for a changing climate. And our research has shown that homes in Finland and Northern Europe are ill-adapted to the increased risk of overheating during heat waves. The good news is that green infrastructures are a key adaptive solution to reduce home overheating risk. It means radical rewilding spaces through the coherent design of home, housing block, and living environment at all of these scales. This then also encourages physical and social activities, which is crucial for people's physical and mental health and well-being at all ages, and not just for older adults or those living alone. Yet green and adaptable infrastructures are often not considered, despite being important for well-being and individual and community resilience. And with the excuse of densifying our living environments, we're increasingly reducing and not increasing residents' visual and physical access to urban nature. We then also miss out on biodiversity and climate change mitigation and adaptation co-benefits. Green infrastructures are also an important aspect of social infrastructures that promote social encounters and interaction between residents. This is really important for the creation of social capital within the living environment to enable sharing of resources, knowledge, and care for each other. For this reason, it is also important to not only see the home as the four walls of the apartment. For example, living in microunits relies on residents not spending much time at home. But if they're located in housing blocks without meaningful shared spaces, or in living environments without the service provisions, or mobility connections to socialize outside the home, it increases loneliness risks in residents. This simple example shows the interconnections between the different scales where living takes place. It also highlights that lack of support in the living environment puts more pressure on the home or on the housing block to meet needs, and vice versa. We're faced with challenges such as a changing climate, pandemics, and more people aging at home. The way we live and occupy our homes and living environments has changed and will continue to change. Our research has indicated that our current housing production is not able to meet current challenges, let alone future ones. Key questions are, how can our research respond and anticipate some of these changes and in turn affect change in the real world. What do any of these shifts mean for the design of housing and living environments? And more broadly, what kind of lives do we want to live individually and as a society? And how can housing match that vision? Most of these aspects are typically not thought about on the architect's drawing board or considered as important by the majority of profit-maximizing developers. But as a professor, I see it as my responsibility to anticipate and investigate these issues and to communicate them to the wider public, policymakers, and industry. And of course, I also tackle these topics in the education of future architects. Clearly, the design of our housing and living environments must change, but also the way we conduct research has changed. People are not just a subject of our research, but are also included in our research. We work with and for them. So together with residents and in my research group, I reimagine and undertake transformative thinking about the home and living environment in terms of social, spatial, and environmental design. We aim to understand current needs and if and how they are met today and whether our current housing designs work. And we reimagine new models of housing and new ways of living that meet today's challenges and anticipate future shifts. These are complex issues that span across disciplines and singular research methods. Every day, I work together with amazingly talented scholars in my team. They bring unique areas of expertise to answer some of these difficult but important questions. We also collaborate and share knowledge with other researchers and groups, learning every day from and with each other. What we all have in common is that we see it as our life's work to create a more sustainable, better tomorrow collectively. We share, we reimagine, so we all thrive.